My first submission to you, young men, is and ladies, is open the blindfold. Open the blindfold and you'll see, you'll become aware in your own sphere. You won't read old men coming and lecturing you. Government as an impersonal entity, as distinguished from the elected drivers. Because I am acutely conscious of the inadequacies that fill up the executive part. Acutely conscious, I have suffered it. You only guess how bad it is. I can tell you how bad it is. One of the reasons why this happens is getting into self-imposed myopia. Getting into self-imposed myopia. I see some of the best guys trying to crack the UPSC for me and then getting in. They come from all spheres, including colleges that I hold in high esteem like this, IIT Kanpur. I don't know what happens after that. Is it the comfort of the thing? Is it the red lights that create all the problem? So that red lights do create problems in different parts. But so what happens, I don't know. But then the execution. I assume that the best, what happens is the machinery itself has a crushing effect. But more than that, it's a switch off this awareness bulb. In other words, it was mandatory for the ICS to take incognito trips in to find out. I imagine that would be rather difficult, but they would. In the early days of 50s and 60s, it was almost mandatory for you to get out wearing a dhoti kurta or something, wearing lungi and sort of go and try to find out. After that, what happened, I don't know. So I pick up from her because I have as much frustration on this call. I'm getting worried about the increasing dichotomy between a more conscious society demanding its justified rights and the complete ineptitude and placidity of a Bourbon-like regime in the corridors of power of Shastri Bhavan, of all the bloody Bhavans, where you find that they are still writing PUC is a DUC, paper under consideration is duty under consideration, some other crap. So that's how they still behave. I mean, their response system is so poor. DIKW pyramid. Have any of you guys heard it? Okay, catch up on it. It should be available in any library. DIKW refers to data, information, knowledge, and wisdom. It is one of the crossing challenges of management. What is the difference between these four layers? Data, information, knowledge, and management. Knowledge and wisdom. You have lots of scholars giving lots of, just pick up one of the smaller books, or even Google it, you'll find. There are lots of philosophers and lots of people who have thought about this, and the universal conclusion is that these are four layers. Data comes to you in bits, bytes, symbols, information, I mean, bits, bytes, symbols, and whatever is visible. Okay? Number of guys in this room, that's the data. Number of empty chairs, data. How many people? That's all data. Data is usually true because it reflects without with total objectivity, programmed as it is to reflect that part only. Okay. Information is what flows out of the data. The next level, when you interject it to some richness. Knowledge is what you try to gain from both the data and the information. And is again built upon your programming of birth, breeding, peer group, and the institutions. This is where programming takes place. After this, you'll be a self-programmed autocrat. I mean, nobody else is responsible for your mistakes after this. Until now, you can blame the whole world. Okay, knowledge and wisdom is something that comes, it hasn't dawned upon me, but I'm sure it will find its time to reach mature levels. It secretes up where you get a holistic view of what's happening. So DIKW was a very interesting pyramid. There are lots of guys who worked on it. I remember Zelny, Ashtroff. I have lots of people have worked on it. So just try catching up with it so it's there in one bit of your memory scape. It'll help you. remember, try to remember them if you can, otherwise I'll email it to you. One is programming, the other is prodigious, and the third is provoked. Choose whichever one you will. Programmed perception is to, for instance, to look at things in a very programmed manner. Programming is not necessarily taught to you. Program could be genetically provocative. You know what I mean? Genetically there. To look upon X creature as bad. To look about, and this program is terrible, I tell you, terrible. It's sometimes when you're approaching someone, you can't figure out his name, you can't figure out where you met him, but you figure out you don't like him. You get those computer blips and you sort of turn your face around. You brand people with extra teeth, they didn't ask for it, as somebody who's betrayed you. So therefore, I mean, you cast aspersions, you pigeonhole people, you take all sorts of things and you sort of down your senses. Programming, this could be from your past experience, it could be from your family values, that since I'm being brought up in a good Jan house, anybody who touches onion is perhaps ipso facto bad. It could be anything, it could be anything. Or you could be born into a bong house and think, oh, you don't know Rabindra Sangeet? How fit. So, it depends on whatever perception is programmed into you. Perceive the world in terms of programming. This is the automatic armory and instruments that we give you from the time you land up in this planet till the time you are free to commit your own mistakes. You do a few of them during the incubation period as well. Nothing compared to what you are capable of doing after you have crossed 2022. So programmed is one. The second one, as I said, is a bit of intuitive. Have you heard of prodigy? It comes to them naturally. You know, for some success comes so easy, those tick-a-tad sorts. Some people it comes easy. I never fell in that category. I was always a backbencher, could never make it. But chalo. There are luckier ones who sort of pick up knowledge, pick up experience very fast, and they can sort of layer it over their own programming and come to a second view. If this is what my perception is, this is what my intuition is, this is what it is, and most of the time they turn out to be right in the canteen and say, chalo, 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 you all laid your bets. Now, time to take a call. This is the second one. It's not necessarily that they are the heroes there. In the family also, people go up to people who have that insight, what I call the Tauji insight. The third is provoked. And provoked perception is what I'm going to tell you guys today. I'll give you one provoked perception and leave you for the rest of your lives. Think about it. Everything you see around the hall, everything, I'm referring to everything, take a quick view around and you'll see something very interesting. You will see a grid geometry dominating your ecosystem. Everything is in grids. Everything here of human being is in geometric progression, geometric shape. Almost predictable. Matching, balancing, sequencing. Everywhere. If the chair is a curve, the exact curvature is repeated everywhere. In other words, man's own products based upon his perception is on the grid geo block. Perceptions and analysis can work on some theories like this, some keys which are different, which nobody else has thought of, which nobody else knows. And when you're looking at, getting bored at some street crossing in a car or outside it, you just look around to see this little test to keep you engaged. I keep doing it all the time to see if I can find any object. So as I said, the mechanical versus the biological. Then can't we come to terms? Well, biomechanics is trying to. It's trying to reach the fluidity of the human hand by working on levers, that can replicate nature. It takes a long time. We can. Maybe we can. We have started cloning.
Let's see. So they said, this is the seventh substance of what I would call awareness.
It's an ability to influence a group for achieving a vision or a set of goals. Anubhava was also a leader. He had a different set of goals. It requires to look above the crowd, challenge status quo's ideas. That is the most important. Create a vision for the future. Leaders inspire, coax, and guide. This is the crossroads that a leader has to choose from. Ethics is only one of them. Dilemma, morals, compliance, wrong, benefits. There are a lot of other signages that greet a person. Ethics are a set of moral principles that influence people to make decisions. Now, without this particular integrated chip, everything else goes wrong, as you'll see. Values of an individual or society are inculcated by the social economic system, or by religion, or by family, or by beliefs. The most important thing is there are no absolute values. This is absolutely correct and that is absolutely wrong. It's always in comparative terms, but it's always higher than common day temptations. Leaders, why don't they need ethics? They need leadership. This is a simple point that I make after 40 years in the system. For emerging as professionals, not as mercenaries. This is one thing you must remember. At the end of the day, one could be a successful doctor, but behind your back, people will say you are a mercenary. That does not help person's image. Larger groupings are appearing in society. Society, that was in very small terms, are now emerging in larger and larger groups. Politics, business, sports, culture, media. Therefore, this calls for the rules of the game. As long as it's a small group of 20 people, one can keep talking and keep sorting out equations. When to the larger group, like we have today, there are rules of the game. Some of those who broke the rules of the game are disasters. Enron. You remember the beautiful lady coming and talking to a senior minister? It was a disaster. Enron. Lehman. Lehman Brothers. Merrick's Bank. Anderson. Four many examples of top firms that crashed before our eyes. Doomed to unethical practices, fudging of accounts. Our own examples of the man who was followed by God in the 1990s, Harsha Mehta. He used to stand in front of the best cars. Rajat Gupta, a personal friend. Satyam Rajat. Subrat Roy. I hope I made my point clear. Leadership ethics. In 1978, I was SDO Barrackpore, in charge of Salt Lake and all these places, and I was in charge of Calcutta Airport. In 78, Mr. Gandhi was indicted in a theft case in Manipur. The great lady was involved in a theft case or some silly case in Manipur, and she used to pass through Calcutta Airport. On one of the journeys that she was passing by, there's this airport hotel which had a glass door. So when she was coming in and going out, her supporters, who were not very polite, had fisticuffs and fights among themselves, and the glass door was broken. The press made a lot of sound about it, that the Prime Minister of India has been, ex-Prime Minister has been threatened by the left front government. So the left front government asked me, what the hell are you doing? I said, what am I supposed to do? He said, next time you go there. I said, right. Found out which flight she was coming back from Manipur. I positioned myself in the airport hotel. And there I found the different groups of leaders talking among themselves. And they were all waiting for her. The story is a long one, but I'll cut it short. How I was outwitted by the lady. Because they were in a belligerent mood, I declared 144 and pushed her back. She landed up, we took her in a car and rushed with three cars straight in the airport hotel. As she was coming through the gate, I had instructions that even if people get on top, just bring her into the hotel. She came into the hotel and said, why was I not allowed to get out? Nobody answered. Who has declared this order? And then the police, senior most police officers, they would not take the responsibility, they pushed me. At 23 or 25 or 26, you know how skinny I looked. She said, he is the one who declared. Looked at me, completely unimpressed, decided to go by. Anyway, as she was going up to her room, she was followed by a short man with black hair and big spectacles called Pranab Mukherjee. Followed by another person going like this, Abhar Parkar Manikhan Chaudhary. She was followed by all these leaders. But she walked faster than everybody else. And I was the only one who could keep pace with her. As she went to the door of her guest room, she stopped for half a second. The mat was turned around. She stopped, put the mat straight with her toes, and then went. One of the world's busiest person could see that the mat was a little turned around, askew. It stopped there, the tip of her toe turned the mat around, straight. straightened it and then walked in. I never forgot that lesson in my life. You never are too busy for the detail. She could have just walked over and turned out bad, and she could have gone out because she was spending half an hour. Question is, I never forgot that the world's busiest person had the time to walk, see that the mat was not correct, turn it around with a toe and walk in silently, thinking that nobody had noticed. One young man had noticed.